Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Knoll, and where we would normally be discussing the issues of health and nutrition and the environment and important social issues, investigative reporting, or white papers, today, something I find far more important, but virtually untouched by the mainstream media. We're going to be talking about exposing the truth behind Russiagate. My guest is Ray McGovern. Later, we will be hearing from Jimmy Dore, interviewing the head of Greystone, talking about new documents. Now, why is this program important? Why should we all be concerned about what Ray will be revealing? Simply put, for more than 3.5 years, every day on every one of the networks, we had heard discussions by so-called experts, objective experts, like, Comey, or the head of the CIA, or the head of the National Security Agency, Clapper. And we heard from all these other pundits that the only reason that Trump was elected is because of Russia interference. And we know that because much of what was on John Podesta's emails became public after Russia tapped in to the DNC, Democratic National Committee, and downloaded files, thousands, tens of thousands of files from Hillary Clinton and their server, and then shared these. And that's what allowed all this to tip. So it was 24/7, nonstop. And here's why I didn't do any programming on it, because we needed hard prima facie proof that what they were saying was correct, and we didn't have it, we had opinion, or not correct, because we didn't have oath telling us. So I didn't do any programs on this until today, because just last week, last Thursday, Friday, and then this week, files have been made public that we would not have seen from Schiff, who headed at that time the House Committee on Intelligence, and therefore in closed door under oath statements, virtually everyone who had proclaimed with their opinion, not under oath, on these television programs, like everyone's show on MSNBC and CNN, and that clearly there was total proof that that Trump was a Russian agent, that all of his operatives were Russian agents, that General Flynn was a Russian agent, and therefore whatever could come their way, including impeachment, they deserved. Now we find out none of that was. They lied. All of them lied. Now, when you consider the level of intellect, life experience, academic achievement, the development of scholarship in their given fields, how could hundreds of journalists and broadcasters be all wrong? I don't have the answer to that, but the evidence suggests, and Ray McGovern is going to lay it out in detail, that most of the liberal media has been brainwashed from the deception behind Russiagate. Therefore, it is necessary for people to unlearn what they've been told to believe for so long. We are dealing with a media that is predisposed to not believe it. So we're going to ask Ray to use his time to help people unlearn the fabrications, the pathological lying, the obfuscation that they gave to the public, but behind the scenes, no one, not a single person, was willing to go on the record under oath of saying, yes, we had absolute documentation that there was Russian interference and that these people were co-opted as Russian agents. No one had proof of that. And Ray's going to lay that in detail. And then later in the program, we're going to hear from Gray Zone's Aaron Mate, who says, quote, to be clear, CrowdStrike, the private company the intelligence community relied on, says it believes Russia hacked into the DNC, but it admits under oath to having no direct evidence whatsoever of Russians actually exfiltrated, meaning removed, the emails from the DNC. This would tack with what Assange has said. Russia may have hacked DNC, but they did not provide any stolen emails, end quote. So what role does Mueller have in this, especially given CrowdStrike's relationship with him and the FBI. And what was Adam Schiff's, Clapper's, Susan Rice's, and other aligned with Democrat individuals' motivation for denying they knew anything about it? Why no headlines about this? So we're going to have Ray McGovern, who is at raymcgovern.com and consortiumnews.com, unravel this story. I'll sign off by saying that Ray McGovern served as an Army intelligence officer and a CIA analyst for 27 years under seven presidential administrations, from John F. Kennedy to George H.W. Bush. Along with his duties was preparing the president's daily brief, which was a one-on-one to President Ronald Reagan's most senior national security advisors. Hence, he was the cipher that took all the different intelligence reports, put them into the most important briefing of the day. So he was on top of everything. By the way, Ray has been a vocal peace activist and journalist and helped create Veteran Intelligence Professionals for Sanity to expose the way intelligence was falsified to justify the war in Iraq, and the San Adams Associate for Integrity and Intelligence. He received that award. He also works with Tell the World, an ecumenical Catholic publishing house. Nice to have you with us today, Ray.
Thank you. I'm glad to be back.
Ray, let's begin with the idea that most people listening are not aware of what was just turned over as evidence, under oath evidence, and that not a single one of these people under oath, these so-called experts that we saw hundreds of times on cable news declaring that Russia, 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 that none of this was true, and they were not willing to admit it under oath, and then unfurl the story here so we can understand it. The form is yours.
Sure. Well, I was just going to start out by saying that I've been in and around Washington for 60 years now, and 27 of those years were spent as a CIA analyst, a substantive person, a briefer of presidents. And I've kept with it, with our organization of Veteran Intelligence Professionals for Sanity, which we set up right before the Iraq War, when we could see that the process of intelligence had been corrupted and that there was no ample justification for the war in Iraq. So I've been around a while, and I've seen a lot. I've seen a lot of really bad stuff. But nothing, I have to say that, nothing compares to what we have watched over the last 3.5 years. And we, Veteran Intelligence Professionals for Sanity, have in our midst two former directors, two former technical directors of the National Security Agency, NSA, and we have all manner of other people. And so we put our heads together and said, you know, we need to keep doing what we used to do out there when we were on active duty, so to speak. We have to spread some truth around. And we started doing that in November and December of 2016, when we could see that this push for alleging Russian interference through hacking of the DNC emails and other manners of interference, that they were really not supported by good evidence. You see, we do evidence. I was shocked at one point where John Brennan, testifying before Congress, said very emphatically, "I don't do any evidence." Well, hello, I mean, that's what we did. And if we didn't have enough evidence, then we admitted that we were interpreting, that we were making judgments based on the limited intelligence we had. So that's our kind of shtick, right? Evidence. And we could see none to justify this. Now, just another word about the background here. We could see that when Bob Mueller was appointed to look into this Russia, Russia, Russia thing, that he would be cajoled into getting the information from Comey and others who had worked very closely with him, and that even so, he would be above manufacturing evidence. Now, please don't misunderstand. I have seen evidence manufactured, and that was the evidence on weapons of mass destruction, manufactured by Rumsfeld and Cheney and the others. That was manufactured, and indeed, the head of the Senate Intelligence Committee talked about made up, false, contrived absence of intelligence in their final report. So this was not a case of made up evidence. It was just evidence that Bob Mueller couldn't bring himself under the strictures of logic and the law to charge anyone in the Trump administration with collusion, or the real legal word is conspiracy, with Russia to affect the election. Now, we could say that there was no evidence of that, and Mueller indeed decided that he couldn't manufacture it, and he issued a statement, no collusion. Now, bigger question, the question at the core of all this is, okay, there was no collusion between the Trump administration and Russia on what? Well, on the election. Well, who said the Russians did something? Well, the entire intelligence community said they did something. What did they do? And this is the cornerstone here. They hacked into the Democratic National Committee, exfiltrated the emails from the DNC, and gave them to WikiLeaks for publication. WikiLeaks published them 3 days before the Democratic National Convention. It was on the 22nd of July, 2016. The convention started 3 days later. So what we have here is a very, very strong accusation that the Russians hacked into the DNC. And what do those emails show, the emails that Russia purportedly hacked, got, and gave to Julian Assange of WikiLeaks? What did they show? Well, please listen, because this is really important. They showed that the Democratic National Committee and the Hillary campaign hopelessly prejudiced the primary process against Bernie Sanders. It's not too much to say that they stole the nomination from Bernie Sanders. And that was pretty electric. Hello? That's what those emails showed. Now, 3 days before the convention, how was Hillary going to handle that? Well, we know from reconstructing what happened that they decided to blame it on Russia, to blame the publication of these things on Russia, saying Russia gave them to WikiLeaks, and distract the entire attention of the American community into focusing on Russia, 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 and very few people actually read the emails. So let's get back to the so-called Russian hack. And I should preface this part by saying that we, in our ethos of objective intelligence analysis, well, it's been so passé, it's been so kind of outdated now, that very few people can wrap their minds around the fact that when we were working at CIA and other intelligence organizations on analysis, we were paid to tell the truth. I mean, we walked around Washington and we would say on occasion, you know, we're the only outfit around here that has no political agenda. We work directly for the president, but we tell it like it is, without fear or favor. Now, in Washington, people would stop and they'd look at you like you had two heads on you. They look, in Washington, everybody has an agenda. Are you telling me you worked for a place that had no agenda? I said, yeah, that's what I'm telling you. You got to trust me. And I have to tell you, that's the way it was up until the very end of my career, which was late 80s and 90s. So what I want to say here is that our conclusion about Russian hacking coincidentally with something that Trump says. It is, in my personal view, the only thing that I can say that I agree that Trump is right about. I think Trump is the worst president the United States ever had, and I shudder at the thought that by revealing the truth, I might be helping him in some way. And that's why I've lost a lot of friends. They don't understand. My oath is the Constitution of the United States, okay? That is, to swear to abide by the Constitution without fear or favor, and despite enemies, whether they're foreign or domestic. Well, these are domestic people who try to prevent the President of the United States from taking office, and then to make sure that he could either be removed or rendered ineffectual, and they have succeeded greatly in the latter. Now, getting back to the recently revealed documents. On December 5th, 2017, what's that, 17, 18, 19, whoa, that's a long time ago, 2017, December 5th, Adam Schiff, head of the House Intelligence Committee, interviewed this fellow named Sean Henry. Now, Sean Henry was the head of CrowdStrike, but he had a long career, 26 years, if memory serves, as chief cyber guru for a fellow named Bob Mueller. Okay, so he retired and took over the headship of CrowdStrike, and he testified before the Shift Committee about the Russian hack. And Schiff kept this testimony secret until last Thursday, okay, so 5 days ago. Now, what did Sean Henry say under oath? He said, and Aaron Mattei can elaborate on this, he said, in effect, there was no evidence that the DNC emails were exfiltrated, were hacked and given to the Kremlin. No evidence, okay? No evidence that they were hacked by Russia or by anybody, okay? No evidence. Whoa, no concrete evidence. What do you have? Well, we have circumstantial evidence. Some of the things we observed, the techniques, are commonly used by the Russians and others, and it was really a debacle because the whole case about Russian hacking into the DNC in an attempt to demolish Hillary Clinton fell down in that one interview. So I wrote that right up. I mean, it was really amazing. And I explained how CrowdStrike was brought in by the DNC itself. Okay, so you have CrowdStrike being paid by the Democrats. You also have Christopher Steele being paid by the Democrats. Are you sensing a pattern here? Anyhow, they're brought in, okay, and there's alleged to be a Russian hack of the DNC, and CrowdStrike is going to look into it, okay? Now, when Jim Comey, the head of the FBI at the time, was asked by Congress, well, didn't you want to get a hold of those machines and take a look at them yourself? I mean, you have cyber experts. And Comey said, well, no, we asked at various levels if we could to inspect the machines, and we agreed to a deal where CrowdStrike would do the work, and they're a first-rate agency, by the way, and they'll give us the results. Well, number one, they're not a first-rate agency. They had simultaneously been required to retract findings that they had done with respect to Ukraine and some cyber work that they had to admit was completely false. Okay, so they weren't this crackerjack cyber agency, and it's so Senator Burr. Remember now, Senator Burr is in the news for what he did with his stock stuff, but he was the head of the Senate Intelligence Committee. He said, "Now, Mr. Comey, isn't it best practice to actually have physical possession of the computers and server and figure out what happened?" And Comey said, "Well, yes, yeah, sure. It would have been yes, but they wouldn't let us, and so we worked out this deal." Wouldn't let us? The head of the FBI? I mean, this is a time when John McCain is shouting from the rooftops, "This is an act of war. The Russians have committed an act of war," and so are many other commentators. And James Comey decides, well, maybe he'd let a lower echelon official ask the DNC if they could pretty please maybe look at their machines, but he never used any of his powers, which he's very free to use on my friends, of subpoena, of getting a letter from a judge saying, look, I'm going to get those machines. So we smelled a rat right off the bat, okay? And sure enough, we found out through evidence in a court case last year, I think around last fall, that CrowdStrike never even gave the FBI a final report. They gave them a couple of drafts, which themselves were redacted by CrowdStrike. This came up in connection with one of the lawsuits that were going on, and the lawyers for the defense were saying, well, let's see this CrowdStrike report. And the government came back and said, there isn't any. The judge said, what do you mean? There's no CrowdStrike report? They said, no, we don't have any. We have a couple of drafts that were given, but they're redacted, and no, we don't have any. Whoa. Well, now we have the head of CrowdStrike getting back to 5 December 2017 testifying before the House Intelligence Committee. Adam Schiff says, when did the Russians exfiltrate that material? There's a pause. Sean Henry consults his lawyer. He says, well, counsel says that it's not clear. We don't know when this email information from the DNC was exfiltrated. We don't have any concrete evidence that it ever was exfiltrated. Wow. Okay. Now, I can see where Adam Schiff would want to keep that under wraps for, what is it now, December, December, more than 2 years. But there it is. It's all laid out. Now, you didn't see any banner headlines in the New York Times on this, did you? Or the Washington Post or the Wall Street Journal? And they've been completely silent on this incredible admission that the whole case, the cornerstone of the Russian interference case having to do with hacking, has just gone down the tubes. The other prong that Bob Mueller investigated, the so-called Internet Research Agency, out of St. Petersburg, they were doing this social media stuff, okay? And we already knew when we consulted with Facebook officials and others, and the New York Times itself admitted that, well, let me just put it this way. If you have a pencil, it's the portion of Facebook activity that was represented by the Russian Internet Research Agency was 0.00000048%. And most of it was after the election was over. So this was a canard that was easily shut down. But you won't, again, you won't find that out from the New York Times. So all I'm saying here is that the twin cudgel here that Bob Mueller was investigating and decided that was evidence that the Russians were trying to interfere, they all fall apart. So now this is a very, very volatile issue, as you can imagine, because the question is, well, number one, if the Russians didn't hack into the DNC and give those emails, those DNC emails to WikiLeaks for publication to hurt Hillary Clinton, well, who did? And the answer, we can attest by forensic study. I recall that I mentioned we had two former technical directors of the NSA in our midst. We can say that, the Russians didn't hack it, and nobody hacked it. Well, how can you say that, McGovern? Well, I can say that because these NSA professionals created the systems that allow U.S. government to track everything that goes over the Internet, like everything. And when I asked them, I said, come on, give me a break. Everything? And they said, Ray, trust us. We built the system. Yes, everything. So what's the conclusion there? The conclusion there is if there were a Russian hack, it would have been collected by NSA or one of our friendly intelligence service associates, and they would have the information, and they don't have the information. So that was our initial misgivings. Later, we learned that Lucifer 2.0, this entity that arose out of the ashes in June of 2016, is a fraud, and we know that, and we can prove it. And one of the ways we can prove it is that he claims to have hacked emails out of the DNC. That particular hack was on July 5, 2016. And we know, and this is physics, okay? This is forensics. We know that that wasn't hacked, that material. We know that it was copied onto a thumb drive. And how do we know that? Because of the speed with which it was downloaded. It was downloaded at three times the speed that the internet at that period of time, namely July 5, 2016, could tolerate. You can't go any faster than one-third of that speed. But not coincidentally, that speed was exactly what a thumb drive could handle and tolerate. So we had that. We have also indications that there was a copying mechanism used called a FAT file system. And we have that technical information, which is really easily understandable, and we're published on it. And we keep chipping away at this thing, but nobody will give us the time of day. No one will listen to us. And now there's going to be a real crisis of cognitive dissonance because everyone, my good friends up in New York who still read the New York Times and still think that they have all the news that's put to print, well, has the Times covered this one? No, they haven't. Will they cover it? Only if they're forced to do that. So what I'm saying here is that inculcated in the minds of Americans for 3.5 years is the notion that the Russians hacked into the DNC, used those emails to discredit Hillary Clinton. Now, bear in mind, one more time, the emails were the ones that discredited Hillary Clinton and the DNC. It wasn't WikiLeaks, and it wasn't the Russians. It was the emails themselves, which, happily for the DNC, escaped much attention because of Russia, Russia, Russia. Why did Russia do this? Maybe I've talked long and too long here on this, but there are all kinds of other facets to this. Let me finish up with where we are now. We know that the FBI has misbehaved in many ways. We know that they lied to the FISA court. You know, that's really important. The Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act Court, which was set up to make sure that Americans or anybody else was not spied on under a counterintelligence investigation capriciously or under false pretenses. And that's perhaps what did happen when they went after this fellow Carter Page, who was a part of the Trump campaign. Now, I have to tell you all that when you get permission from a court like that to spy, you know, it's done electronically, of course, to spy on Carter Page, well, that doesn't mean just Carter Page. That means that everybody who talks to Carter Page, and that means actually everybody who talks to whoever talks to Carter Page. And let's say one of those is using the internet. Well, that means the whole internet. So it's really not just Carter Page. This was justified by a bunch of things, including this dossier, so-called, by Christopher Steele, again, paid by the Democrats. Now, the thing I need to say here so that people can understand it is the answer to this question. My friends say, especially the ones that read the New York Times up in New York, Ray, my God, are you saying that the very top law enforcement officials and intelligence officials of our country all lied? And I have to say, well, listen, you can explain this. And the explanation lies not only in their character, but in the situation that obtained in the fall of 2016. Hillary was sure to win. They all thought Hillary. Who didn't think Hillary's going to win against that buffoon? Okay? Now, how do I know that that was their mindset? Well, not only logic, unless they were, you know, clairvoyant, but also Jim Comey in his wonderful book about loyalty. Jim Comey says at one point, and I quote, "I was operating in an environment in which I was sure that Hillary Rodham Clinton was going to be the next president of the United States," period, end quote. Well, look, if you're operating in that kind of environment, you know she's going to win. And you don't have the character to follow the law to the T. Well, you're going to take all kinds of liberties with the law, all kinds of liberties with the Constitution, all kinds of liberties with the FISA Act and the strict restrictions against collecting against Americans. Why? Well, because you can help her win. And then when she does win, you can get her promoted. You're certainly not going to get indicted. Now, that was the big mistake. They all thought she was going to win. And a corollary of that is this, that when you're sure she's going to win, and you're going to do all these things that you can prove helped her win, you don't hide your tracks. You don't take the trouble to hide your tracks. You're not some professional intelligence officer who makes sure that the tracks are hidden. No, you. And so why am I saying all this? I'm saying that the government now, Trump's government, including Attorney General Barr and the U.S. attorney out there in Connecticut, to John Durham, they have the book on these guys. They have the evidence, whether it's on paper or in computers. They know what happened. And the only question is whether John Durham, he's doing this special investigation on how the Russia investigation started by the FBI, and it's much wider ranging investigation. It includes the CIA, NSA, and others, much wider than what the Department of Justice has done a couple months ago. So what am I saying here? I'm saying that the evidence is there, that the FBI overreached, the FBI dissimulated, the FBI lied to the FISA court and to others, and so did CIA. CIA was in on this, preparing what they call an intelligence community assessment. That's what they call it. Only one word of that title was correct. It was an assessment. It wasn't based on any evidence. We assessed this, we assessed that, and we assessed this other thing with high confidence. That's the way it read, okay? It wasn't the intelligence community.
Okay, Ray.
It wasn't even...
Let me intercede here for...
of the intelligence.
I'd like to share some thoughts for the next part of our discussion here. And if you could please give us just a little shorter answers. Here's what my research and my subjective opinion brings me to. When I took a look pulling back from the Russia probe and Russian collusion and all that came from that, finding now that it was all lies. And it's people's own under oath testimony in secret that has just been released, it shows they all lied, some pathologically so, because Adam Schiff would have known that everyone was lying and yet went forth every day proclaiming with absolute self-righteous indignation, of course he was engaged. We have evidence, but he had no evidence. There were four separate investigations and they found no collusion. Now, I pull back a little further and I say, let's take a look. No one expected Trump to win because all of Wall Street supported Hillary Clinton, as they did Obama. All of the big pharma, all of the multinational corporations represented by the Business Roundtable, all the advocates on the Council on Foreign Relations supported Hillary Clinton, as they had Obama. All of the people in big agriculture, like Monsanto, supported Hillary Clinton, as did all the people in the energy cartels, all the major energy cartels, coal, nuclear, high gas hydrofracking, supported her. So, in effect, the entire business world supported Hillary Clinton. None of them supported Trump. So, why would everyone support Hillary Clinton? Why? Because she was compliant. She was the person to protect them. She had all these minions, some stay-behinds from Obama, that were in power positions of technocrats overseeing agencies who became, in effect, became tenured to stay there forever. And so anytime anything went against Obama, against Clinton's, they could cover it up or stop it. I don't want to get into all the examples like Benghazi, but I knew the truth about Benghazi, and I told my audience about Benghazi, why she lied and others would lie, and everybody covered it up because of what where the arms were and how they were breaking treaties by shipping them in to terrorists. But be that as it may, what we had is we had no one in the business world wanted to see Trump get elected, not the credit card companies especially, because of promises he had made during his campaign. So now that he does get elected, though she gets 3 million more of the popular votes, now the idea is, let's take him out. How do we know they wanted to take him out? Because emails showed it. That the day of when she had to concede, there were immediately meetings about her top inner circle people, including Podesta. Let's see what we can do from here. Now, we already know her proclivity for lying and manipulation in the DNC because Bernie Sanders was the legitimate people's choice to fight against Trump, and he would have trounced him, but they got rid of him, unfortunately. But that's the reality. That's politics. You know, you said you've been there 60 years. So what I see is this. I see that the only thing that I can recount that Trump has done right, where he hasn't lied, is that he caused the deep state for the first time to show their power and their influence, how much control they had over the media. People remember back to the mid-1970s, 1974, when the church hearings showed that the media had been totally compromised and infiltrated by the CIA. That was under oath. We know what happened. We were led to believe that all that had all been cleaned up. Nothing had been cleaned up. It had even gotten worse. So now, in my opinion, Ray, we had, at least since Smedley Butler was tried to be recruited back in the 1930s to go against, to create a coup against Franklin Roosevelt by the bankers, we had a coup. And the coup was against Trump and then blaming his supporters, many of whom, by the way, had been historical Democrats and unionists that had been betrayed and never honored the pledges given to them to help them get their jobs back. And they just got, it was a protest vote. So I believe that we had a coup. I believe that the entirety of mainstream media, with a few exceptions, were complicit. I believe these people knew everything, and what they didn't know, they trusted the people that should never have been trusted, like the Adam Schiffs and Comey and Clapper and Brennan, head of the CIA. And since when did the liberal community I grew up in, all right, since when was it okay for a former head of the CIA, a former head of the National Security Agency, to become respected commentators and hence be able to give people their opinion as policymakers, insight as if we're supposed to trust them because their hands are clean? That in itself shows how low the standards have become for accountability instead of bias. So this now has been exposed. The people who, like Flynn, and now the evidence is in, that everything against Flynn was a lie. Yes, he did plead guilty, but only after the U.S. attorney, with information from the FBI, said, we're going to put your son in jail. And so as a good father, he took the fall for his son. But on his watch, nothing he did, nothing, not a single thing, represented a crime except the stupid Logan Act. And no one had ever been tried on the Logan Act in its history. So, but not a word of conciliation, not a word of contrivance, contrition, not a word of we're sorry we got this story wrong. Instead, they doubled down, and today they're doubling down, and I just think it's atrocious. Your thoughts on this, please.
Well, Gary, I'm glad you took a couple steps back. We were getting a little bit lost in the weeds there in my discourse. You're quite right. The big picture has to do with what General Eisenhower, right before he left the presidency, talked about. He talked about the military-industrial complex, You may know that he was encouraged to say military-industrial congressional complex because it was clear even then that Congress was part of this. But no, he thought MIC would be enough, military-industrial complex. Well, the way things have grown since that time, it's possible to use a new acronym that I have devised, and it's called MICIMAT. And you can take a pencil out. It's MICIMAT, MICIMATT, and it stands for Military Industrial Congressional Intelligence Media Academia Think Tank Complex. Now, why do I say media? Well, because media is the cornerstone. Media, without the media deceiving everyone or selling everybody a bill of goods, it doesn't work. So the media, now, what is the media these days? Well, it's controlled. It's controlled by the corporations that run it, and the corporations are the same ones that profiteer on making arms and selling arms. So you've got this complex that has grown like Topsy, and now is pretty much in charge. And that's the complex that you referred to individually as the people behind Hillary Clinton, and it was a big shock to them that she lost. You know, Wall Street, of course, is part of this. And I remember when I was a Russian analyst, beginning of my career, I had to read Pravda and Izvestia every day, and in the original. There was this one propagandistic phrase that the Russians used, Volstritskiye kradapitsy. And I used to say to myself, that's over the top. Come on. Wall Street bloodsuckers, okay? That's just really crazy. Bolstritskiye kradapitsy. Okay, well, you know what? callow youths like me learn as the years go by. 2007, 2008 come along, and now we have the archetypical Wall Street bloodsuckers, whether you call them that or not. There they are. They're even going to profiteer on COVID, for God's sake. So this is a very, very elemental part of this. Now, the other part is what some people call the deep state. Okay, now, since Trump uses that term, it's ipso facto able to be dismissed, okay? But you know what? I can tell you, it's real. And when I try to tell my former colleagues, he has to fess up and admit it. They say, no, it's not real. It's propaganda. I said, look, listen to what the former acting director of the CIA said in November of last year. Oh, what did he say? He said at a public conference, thank God for the deep state. Thank God for the deep state, because it's we who put boundaries on the president and make sure that he doesn't go off hog wild, okay? Oh, wow. This is John McLaughlin. I know him well. I ran his first estimate as the chair of an estimate on Italy. The guy admitted that there is a deep state. Now, I don't like deep state because Trump uses it. So I use national security state. What does that mean? That means the people like Brennan and Comey and Clapper, who, like the media, know what's best for the country, try to make sure that the best thing happens for the country, and that is Hillary should win. Oops, she didn't win. Then what's their prerogative or their predisposition? Well, to cover their tracks, to make sure nobody finds out what they did to impede Trump's win, and then when Trump does get into office, to do everything they possibly can to make sure that they get rid of him, or at least they render him unable first and foremost to what? To improve in relations with Russia. Now, without Russia, what's the Mickey Mat going to do? What is the military, industrial, congressional, intelligence, media, academia, think tank complex going to do? You got to have an enemy. And sure enough, they created enemies. What did they do? Sanctions galore. Expel Russian diplomats. The whole nine yards. Why? Well, because the Russians hacked. So you see how it all comes together here. Not only is there no proof of Russian collusion or Trump collusion or conspiracy, it's the legal word, with Russia, but now, and this is going to be a hard sell to get people to realize, that there was no Russian hacking of the DNC to begin with. I know how that intelligence community, quote, assessment, end quote, was written. It was written, as James Clapper, the head of national intelligence, admitted. It was not written by 17 intelligence agencies, what Hillary said. It was not written by three intelligence agencies, like everybody else said. No, no. It was written by hand-picked analysts of those three, CIA, FBI, and NSA. What does that mean? Well, everybody in Washington knows that if you handpick the analysts, you handpick the conclusions. And that's exactly what happened. Jocularly, I suggest that I know the people, the pickers. James Comey picked John Brennan, and John Brennan picked James Clapper. And they picked one another. Now, of course, they had a couple of sycophants that fell in line. But what John Bryant out there in Connecticut is finding out, I'm sure, because he's interviewing these analysts, is that Brennan said, this is the way it's going to come out. Comey, Clapper all blessed it. And so they came up with this 6 January 2017 memorandum, Intelligence Community Assessment, so-called, which said that Putin himself, they had evidence that Putin himself orchestrated this terrible hacking of the DNC to give the election to Hillary. And James Clapper, now in civilian garb, or at least as a civilian, no longer head of national intelligence, says he's convinced that that did make all the difference. In other words, if the Russians hadn't acted in, then Hillary would be president. And he justifies his saying this by manifesting his expertise on Russia. Say he studied in the old Curtis LeMay School of Advanced Studies on Russia, and he says, you know, the Russians are almost genetically driven to be deceitful, to lie, to steal, to blah 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 blah. It's in their DNA, says James Clapper, head. Oh,
I see. So he knew what was in the DNA of Chekhov, and yeah, he's an idiot. In any case, what you're showing us, Ray, is these were all lies. Now the public can say, no conspiracy theory, conspiracy fact. A small cabal of individuals conspired to try to thwart or eliminate Trump from having any power or influence. And at the same time, today, they're defending China and continuing the attack against Russia. So stupid. Thank you. Ray, we're out of time. Thank you very much.
Okay.
I appreciate you giving your insights.
You're most
Ray
welcome,
McGovern.
Gary.
Now, we're going to go directly into this clip from Jimmy Dore, where he is interviewing the Greystone's editor-in-chief, who was going to give us their insights as well.
It's Aaron Matei, ladies and gentlemen. Hi, Aaron. How are you?
Hi, Jimmy. How are you?
Okay. I'm still, every time I say it, I get I always know I'm saying your name wrong.
I say Hakuna Matata. You know what I mean? You say it how you want to say it.
Okay. pajama.
Yeah.
So yeah. What brings us here today? What brings us here today is they declassified a bunch of stuff. The interviews that Adam Schiff did with the president of CrowdStrike. Who is CrowdStrike, Jimmy? CrowdStrike was the private firm that the DNC hired to investigate the DNC server and see who hacked into it. So the DNC was paying a company. That company then said it was the Russians. And that was good enough for the FBI. So now I'm going to show you how I knew for certain when this Russiagate started, how I knew for certain that it was bunk. It was never going to be proven because I had on Bill Binney on my show. Now, if you don't know who Bill Binney is, he is the number one code breaker in the history of the NSA. Bill Binney is the smartest guy that ever worked there, and he invented a program called Thin Thread, which tracked every cell phone to every other phone in the world so that it couldn't be done. He did it. So they got rid of his program a month before 9/11. his program would have picked up the 9/11 attack. So they went after Bill Binney. They tried to put him in prison. He was smarter than the FBI. He outsmarted them. And he's not in prison today. In fact, today he's out debunking Russiagate, telling the truth, because he's the smartest guy intelligence community has ever seen. And he's got integrity, which usually doesn't go together. He has it. And so here's what he told me about how you can, if the Russians would have hacked the DNC server, you would have known it. And here's why. He's going to explain it to us. Thin thread, correct? That's what it was called, thin thread?
Yes. There were basically two parts to thin thread. The first part was done by my partner, Ed Loomis. That was the acquisition of data. You know, as it's passed down the internet, it gets packetized and it's sent out in packets. Like if you have an email, your email may be broken up into 10 or 20 packets. And these packets would be passed around the internet and then reassembled at the other end. And each of them would have the signatures that would, because these are machines running this. So, you know, the machines have to be told exactly what to do. Otherwise, the data won't get where it's supposed to go. So all of the packets, each of them has the identifying numbers for the packet, the number of packets, the designation of the packet series, and the identifiers of everything that the originator and the ultimate recipient. So all that information is there. And then that allows you to reconstruct it at the other end.
So he's saying that no matter what anybody does on the internet, that the NSA has a copy of it. Because when you said something, they splits it up into packets. And then when it gets to its destination, they reassemble those packets. And the NSA would have a copy of everything. Their IP address, the whole deal. They would know exactly where that came from and what they were doing. So it goes a little further. Okay, so this is what, now we're going to get into the Russian investigation and the hacking, okay, or the supposed hacking of the 2016, because what you said, what I thought I heard Edward Snowden also say, was that if it was the Russians who hacked into the DNC server and John Podesta's server, that the NSA would have that data available to them, that they would already know about the packets and they could release that information. Yep. And since they're not doing that, it makes Edward Snowden think that they don't have that information. Now, is that correct how I presented that, and is it true?
Yes, that's basically the reason I opposed it from the beginning in August of 2016 when they first started saying it, because the intelligence community is not a question of CIA or FBI doing it. It's really NSA's job, and NSA has all the capacity to do that. They've got over 100 taps inside the United States on the fiber network where they're collecting storing all that data going across the fiber network. So that if any packets were passed from the DNC through anywhere in the United States, they'd be able to follow those packets. And also if they went across, see, there's very choke points. The surface where the transoceanic cable surface is where all the foreign communications are going into the country and out of the country. So, and they're tapped too. So they've got all that. So that means that any packets that are going from the United States to Europe, they've got copies of. Okay.
Yeah.
So all they have to do is just look for the DNC IP address and of their server, and they will have all the packets that went across the network to Europe if they did. And since they never said that they did that or that that existed, it told me right away they had no evidence of that.
Well, there you have it. The truth is now known. The entire liberal community in the media and the body politic conspired against the American people, against the Constitution, and against all that's ethical and honorable in order to keep the Clintons and themselves in power. You don't have to like Donald Trump. You can dislike Donald Trump. This, at the end of the day, is not about Trump. It's about the sociopathic personalities who have controlled our lives and policies, both domestic and foreign, for the last 50 years. Thank you all for listening, and have a nice day.
Hey, what's up, man? Brother, what's up? This is a big party, man. Yeah, I can dig it. Right on.